Welcome back. We're continuing our discussion about biological psychology and about biological psychology not only as in reference to this class, but also as a field of study. And one of the most important topics we're going to discuss in this area is neuroplasticity. So I think this is one of the most interesting areas in biological psychology. Because most people know and understand that our physiology can change our experiences and behavior, but what a lot of people don't realize is that our behavior can actually change our physiology. So let's take a step back. I think most of you will agree that physiology can affect behavior. So this is why people may behave differently after a stroke or after taking psychoactive medications. It's pretty clear that that's the case. But it is harder to often realize or accept that your behavior can change your physiology because it's not always easy to see. So we're going to talk a little bit about that. I have a YouTube video that I'll show you that will demonstrate that. But what's cool is that you can change the actual structure and chemistry of your brain. For example, there's research that's demonstrated that there are similar changes in brain chemistry that occur when someone's receiving therapy as occur if someone's getting an SSRI, which is an antidepressant medication. You see similar changes in brain chemistry. That's pretty cool. The brain also wires itself based upon experiences. So pathways that are used more often are strengthened and also are often made larger, whereas those that are used less are pruned away. So we'll talk about when we get to motor control, how the motor areas for hands of, you know, people who play guitar or things like that, how those areas are actually larger based upon that experience. And this isn't something that takes years and years. After a couple of weeks, you start seeing these changes. So the brain is actively rewiring itself all the time. And it's really a neat thing. So we'll discuss that a lot. But first, let me give you this video just because I think it'll give you a nice introduction to this idea.
Our brain's development is guided and shaped by experience during childhood and adolescence. But for most of the 20th century, scientists thought that the brain's malleability was lost by adulthood.
If that's true, then my brain now is the same as it was in that last picture when I was in high school, despite the years that have passed and all the experiences I've had since then. In 1913, neuroanatomist Santiago Ramon y Cajal wrote that the nerve paths are fixed, ended, and immutable. Everything may die, he wrote. Nothing may be regenerated. But we've learned a lot about the brain since then, and we're starting to realize that the adult brain is more dynamic than we ever imagined.
Our earliest understanding of brain development came from experiments on animals. Blocking vision in one eye early in life dramatically reduced the representation of that eye in the brain and could even cause blindness. But blocking an eye later in life had no such effect on the brain or vision.
So the same treatment that caused change in the young brain did not cause change in the adult brain. Then neurologists began to realize that large-scale alterations to the brain or body, such as traumatic injury, did cause changes in the adult brain. We'll come back to our unfortunate amputee in a minute, but first, how does the brain rewire itself? The neuroscientist Paul Bacchirida illustrated this process with a metaphor about getting from one place to another. I need to get from my office here in brain mapping over to my seminar here in Haynes Hall. But I've got a problem. My usual route is blocked by construction. So how am I going to get to my seminar? Well, let's find out.
She begins by trying alternative routes. A similar rerouting process occurs in the brain after a traumatic injury. Just like a person finding a new path, the neurons affected by the injury rewire themselves. Some paths work better than others, and she gradually learns which route is the fastest. Once she does, this new route becomes her routine, and in a similar way, the brain's neurons form new connections.
This process by which the brain changes is called neuroplasticity.
If a person has a limb amputated, the brain still expects to receive sensory input from the limb. Neighboring parts of the brain reroute input to the areas representing the missing limb. So when other parts of the body, like the face, are touched, it can feel like a touch on the missing limb, creating a so-called phantom limb.
Okay, so major injuries can cause changes in the adult brain. But what about more benign, everyday activities? Juggling is a complex activity that requires a unique combination of visual and motor skills to perform. A skilled juggler can keep track of several objects at once, throwing and catching each object with precision, and constantly correcting small errors in the pattern. Could an activity like juggling change a person's brain?
Researchers in Germany taught adult subjects how to juggle and captured images of their brains in an MRI scanner as they became more proficient. Even after just 7 days, the researchers found a measurable increase in gray matter in a brain region critical for visual motion recognition.
So it turns out that a brain-changing event does not have to be a life-changing event. And a universal type of experience, a person's culture, may shape the brain well into adulthood. Researchers in Switzerland followed American exchange students as they learned to speak German and found that learning a new language caused gray matter growth in the left inferior frontal gyrus, an area that's active during language processing. So what does this all mean? It means our brains are more dynamic than we ever imagined, even just a few decades ago. They have the potential for incredible recovery after injury, and they can be shaped by our experiences even in adulthood. All is the result of an amazing process called neuroplasticity.
So I'll put a link in the description for that video in case you want to just go and look at that again. Or you can look at this video again, of course. But I want to give the authors their credit there. But it's a really nice demonstration of neuroplasticity and about how our brain is constantly rewiring itself. And you see changes very quickly. And it's one of the exciting parts of this field because there's so many opportunities. We'll talk about it briefly in a couple slides here, where just because there's a deficit doesn't mean there's not something you can do about it. So it gives you a lot of opportunities for interventions, which as a clinician makes me really excited. So another thing that's important is that social interactions can also result in brain changes. So in rats, if you have rats that are socially isolated, so they're kept away from other rats, the areas that are related to sensing odors are actually smaller. So we know that if, you know, whether or not you're around others, different parts of your brain develop differently. For humans, there's actually a pain experiment where some people are told the pain would be greater than others. And what was cool is there's the same pain either way. And as you'll see it on the next slide, due to just this social difference, just the fact that some were told that the pain would be more than others, there was a significant difference in brain activation. So the brain actually noticed it differently and felt it differently just based on that suggestion, because the pain was actually the same between the two. So here you can see it, where the one on the right is the one that actually got the, was told, they got the same pain, but was told that it'd be severe, whereas the one on the left is the ones that were told it would be mild. And you see a significant difference in activation. So you do see these big differences just based on social influences. So again, what we're seeing is that all this is very malleable. It's not just that we experience what the brain perceives, and it perceives things the same way. Social influences affect what we perceive. Our past history affects what we perceive. So there are a lot of behavioral influences in these things that you think are very, very biological, very mechanistic. Biological psychology can also help us understand brain disorders and devise treatment. So, again, I think about psychiatric disorders a lot because I'm a clinician. So we know roughly 1 in 5 people suffer from some form of neurological or psychiatric disorder. And so with that, a large thrust of biological psychology is understanding what is happening in those disorders. What is going on, and how can we fix this? You know, what are ways we can try to either use brain plasticity to help make up for the deficit, or maybe use a medication? You know, just what are the options? So here you see that, again, about 19% of people in the U.S. meet criteria for a mental disorder, and you can see anxiety and substance use are the biggest ones. Depression also very high. Then there's schizophrenia. Schizophrenia is a very serious mental disorder where you have, usually its hallmark symptom is hallucinations, often auditory hallucinations, sometimes visual, but those are rare. And you can have some delusional thinking, you can have some cognitive deficits, very cognitive disorder. So schizophrenia is a nice one to point out when it comes to biological psychology, because it's one where you can often see actual visible differences in brain scans. So here, these are actually twins. So what's interesting is one twin has schizophrenia, the other does not. And with that, what you see is there's a difference in these ventricles here. So here you have roughly normal-sized ventricles, and the person with schizophrenia has larger ventricles. And this is a pretty, you also can actually see it in other parts of the brain. You have a little more thinning of brain matter pretty much throughout, but the ventricles really stand out. So this is a pretty hallmark sign. Not everyone with schizophrenia will show this, but many do. So with that, let me show you another brain scan that I think will blow your mind. So keep in mind the size of these ventricles. This is another brain scan, believe it or not. These are the ventricles. They're very large. So would this person be experiencing schizophrenia? No, actually probably not. This is actually a disorder called hydrocephalus. It's a excess of, it's a buildup of cerebral spinal fluid in the brain, and what it does is it causes pressure, so it kind of pushes all the brain matter against the skull, as you can see. You can see there's a lot less, here you have a lot more of the folds, and you can kind of see the folds. Here it's just all squished. So you have it all squished around the sides, and you have much larger ventricles that are filled with this excess cerebral spinal fluid. But these individuals, again, you know, often do not have symptoms of schizophrenia. That would be very rare in this disorder. So just having large ventricles is not a sign. You know, it's not something that you can use diagnostically to say, yes, this person has schizophrenia, or no, they don't. But it is something that we look at as far as it's a correlation. It's certainly not causal, though, and that's what I'm illustrating here. Although not nearly as prevalent as mental disorders, neurological disorders are also quite prevalent. There are a number of people, as you can see, there are a lot of people who have neurological disorders in the United States, millions if you add up all of them. So why do we care about this? Why do we care in biological psychology? And the answer is because psychological interventions can drastically improve quality of life and sometimes even help people regain skills that were lost through utilizing that neuroplasticity like we talked about with that video. So an example that I have for this that really stood out for me is there are interventions that can affect not only that person's quality of life, but also the family's quality of life. So I was working at a psychiatric nursing home, and there's one patient that would continually, again and again, Alzheimer's patient, asked the same question. Asked it again and again and again. And the staff got tired of answering. Her family got tired of answering. So what can we do about this? What can psychology do about, you know, something like this? Well, actually quite a bit. You can still learn and have Alzheimer's. Those are not mutually exclusive. So what we did is, it was actually a conditioning paradigm where every time she'd ask the question, we actually put, she had a front pocket like this, and we put a card with the answer to the question in her front pocket. And every time she asked the question, we told her to reach for her front pocket. So eventually, the question got paired with reaching for the front pocket, getting the card, and reading the card. And over time, she learned that actually when she had that question, she'd reach for the card, and there was the answer. So that was something that actually made her life a lot better, because she could always get that reassurance of what the answer was without asking a staff member. And it actually improved the quality of life of family and staff as well, because they didn't have to keep answering the same question again and again. So that's just one example of how psychological interventions can be used to improve quality of life.